So we now move on to our next speaker, Dr. Nishino. He's the director of the Department of Neuromuscular Research. His main focus is on the diagnostics and the pathophysiology of muscle disorders. And he will be talking on basic approach to muscle diseases and beyond.
Okay. Thank you very much for your kind introduction. I'm so honored to be here on this special occasion. So I'm going to talk on the basic approach to muscle disease. So you already saw this one. Some of you have attended the pre-Congress workshop and saw the same picture. But still I want to show this again. So this, you know the diagnosis, very easy, right? Even a small kid can make a diagnosis once they learn it. Because this is central core disease, because muscle fibers. My question is, can you make a diagnosis of central core disease without muscle biopsy, without muscle pathology? Of course, no, because the definition of this disease is purely based upon this finding, pathological findings. You just learned from Dr. Sara that the importance of the muscle pathology in the diagnosis of muscle disease. In fact, actually, many of muscle diseases, especially congenital myopathy, they are defined by pathological findings. Look at that one. The picture on the top is Nemaline myopathy. Okay? Nemaline myopathy can be diagnosed because of the presence of Nemaline bodies. The second one, you know the diagnosis already, central core disease. The third one is myotubular myopathy, because they look like myotubes, okay? The last one is central nuclear myopathy, because of the presence of the nucleus in the center of muscle fibers. All those diseases are defined by pathological findings. So of course, experts can make a discussion in front of the patient at bedside. Okay, this patient may have Nemaline myopathy, but all you can say is may, or my, could, something like this. You cannot make a definite diagnosis by clinical observation or evaluation. Again, because these diseases are defined by pathological findings. So actually, in almost all muscle diseases, well, they are actually classified or even defined by pathological findings. So even in this molecular era, I really want to emphasize the importance of muscle pathology. So muscle pathology still plays a central role in the diagnosis of muscle diseases. So as you just learned from Dr. Sara, without muscle pathology, you have a disaster, unfortunately. But you know, the neuromuscular disease, especially muscle diseases, are still rare. But at the same time, you know, for muscle pathology, as you just learned, you need expertise, special knowledge, and technique. So not everybody can work on it. For this reason, actually, most muscle biopsy samples from all over Japan come to our lab. I say 70%, maybe more than 80%. For this reason, you know, my mentor, Dr. Nonaka, started this, you know, the diagnostic service more than 30 years ago in 1978. In the first year, we had only 16 samples. But this year, still we have next week, but as of yesterday, we had more than 900 biopsies. Okay, this actually makes my life very busy. But anyway, I believe that centralization is a key, because not everybody can do this. You should have somebody very reliable who will be responsible for muscle biopsy diagnosis. So this is my proposal. Okay, but at the same time, we do a lot of genetic testing. Okay, and we have our own next generation sequencers And we have done more than 3,000 analyses so far in the last several years. And we have panel sequencing and whole exome sequencing, and of course we do Sanger sequencing and other type of genetic analysis. But the question is, again, okay, in this molecular era with MGS, can we skip muscle biopsy? This is the question. Okay. So let's think about this one. You know that the last slide shows nemaline myopathy. Okay. The first causative gene identified for nemaline myopathy was ACTA1. Okay. Actually, this was reported originally identified by Nigel Lin, who is one of our board members from LMC. So nemaline myopathy, okay. But the story is not that simple at all. At least four diseases can be caused. Four muscle diseases can be caused by ACTA1 mutation. So even if you find ACTA1 mutation, it doesn't necessarily mean that your patient has nemaline myopathy. It can be something else. This is the problem. And also, so far, at least there are 10 causative genes for nemaline myopathy, and still more, because we have many undiagnosed, genetically undiagnosed nemaline myopathy cases still. So the genotype-phenotype correlation is very complicated. So just doing, you may think that, okay, if you do next generation sequencing, or next generation sequencing, you may think that you can get genetic diagnosis, but the reality is not that simple at all. So you still need phenotyping. So I believe that we are actually okay. I want to discuss another case. This case was introduced from other next generation sequencing guy. He was collaborating with one, I won't say his name, but one famous pediatric professor. And according to that next generation sequencing guy, that this case was introduced or diagnosed as congenital muscular dystrophy by that famous professor. Okay? And they luckily identified new causative gene. And he consulted just to make sure that this case is a congenital muscular dystrophy. And I saw this muscle. Yes, it looks like, you know, there is fiber size variation and a lot of fibrous tissue in the interstitium. So it looks, you know, apparently it looks dystrophic, but this is modified Gomery trichrome staining. You can see dot-like structure in the muscle fibers. They are nemaline bodies. So this case has nemaline myopathy, not congenital muscular dystrophy at all. Okay? So if he didn't consult me, this new gene would have been reported as a new causative gene for congenital muscular dystrophy. This is totally misleading, right? But this actually is the causative, this was the causative gene for new nemaline myopathy. Okay, so yeah, actually this was reported several years ago. So it means we still need muscle biopsy, because most muscle diseases are characterized, classified, even defined by pathological features. We still need it. So I think that we are actually, but because of this type of extensive sequencing analysis, most likely in the future, in many of muscle disease cases, you can probably skip muscle biopsy, but not now. I believe that we are in the period of paradigm shift. So in the future, probably all muscle diseases will be redefined by mutation or by gene function or whatever. But at this moment, most muscle diseases are defined or classified by pathological, of course clinical as well, clinical pathological features. So you can't skip this part. So we are in a period of paradigm shift. So it means that we need both genotyping and phenotyping. And we really need to establish genotype-phenotype correlation. So we are in this period, and this is why we need, of course, clinical evaluation or observation, and pathological, this is muscle biopsy, so still necessary. In terms of clinical observation, of course, this is very important. This is very, well, one of the most famous clinical sign. Yes, this one. You know this sign, right? This is Goward sign. Okay? This is, I think everybody knows this one. But, you know, this, when you ask patients to stand up, do you know why is this? Why they take this type of, you know, maneuver? Actually, to stand up from the floor, you have to extend three joints. The hip joints, knee joints, and ankle joints. You have to extend three joints, okay? I actually checked how long he took to extend each joint. So look at this one. The first one, to extend his knees. This one, knee and ankle. To this one, to the first feature, to the second, he took only 0.1 second. Very quick. But for the, he took more, nearly 3 seconds. For the remaining, the 2 point some seconds, actually, he used this long time just to extend his hip joint, right? In the next picture, he already extended knees and ankle. But from the second picture to the last, what he was doing is to extend his hip joints, okay? Look at this again. Can you click it? Very quick, then it took a long time, right? Now it looks a bit different, right? Okay, and actually, so you just learned from Dr. Sara the importance of muscle MRI. This is a different patient, but still this is important. Look at this, his hip muscle. This is already infiltrated by fat. This is why the hip muscles look white. But look at the calf muscle, they look very normal. Thigh muscle, maybe half, a little bit affected. So this clearly shows that hip muscles, right? Gluteus maximus muscles is the one which extends hip joints, are very much affected from very early, right? So this clearly correlates very well with the clinical signs, right? So this, the MRI is very important. Muscle imaging is very important. Okay, so Duchenne muscular dystrophy, I think everybody knows the sort of clinical Goward sign and also calf muscle hypertrophy are very important signs. And typically they lose ambulation around age 10 and they develop respiratory failure before age 20. And in the old textbook, they said that most patients die before age 20 because of respiratory failure. But nowadays, they live much longer. This paper is old one. This was published already 5 years ago. In Japan, so previously, they die before age 20 on average. But nowadays, they live more than 30 years. Actually, I know some patients who are in their 60s. So they really live long. This is, of course, we still don't have curative therapy, gene therapy or whatever, we don't have it. But still they can live long because this is purely because of the improvement of management and care. So this is also very important. So I was so sad to hear the Dr. Sarah's talk because patients just disappear, right, from your clinic. So this is really not good. You can, so there are many things you can do, actually. And of course, this is caused by the dystrophin gene mutation. And most patients have exonic deletions, okay? And of course, if you do muscle biopsy, the diagnosis is very easy because dystrophin is completely absent like this, and the diagnosis can be made very easily. So this is our cohort. We have genotyped more than 1,000 cases in Japan, Japanese patients. As you can see, around 60% of patients have exonic big deletion, and 13% have exonic duplication. These duplication and deletions can be detected by a method called MLPA. I heard that MLPA is available also in Pakistan. But the problem is the remaining 30%. You still need to perform sequencing analysis. For this, usually you need to use next generation sequencing because the dystrophin gene is relatively big. So this is the principle of MLPA. This is very easy. Let's think that there are four exons, and you use probe and you do PCR analysis. And actually, the PCR primers are set, and the PCR to so that product PCR prod each PCR product for each exon will be different in size. And so you can tell which peak corresponds which exon, okay? So if you have deletion like this, of course the result will be like this. So you can tell very easily which exons are missing. Very simple and very easy test, okay? So this is actually the actual data, and of course I don't go into the detail, but in this case from exon 20 to 47 are deleted. So in Japan, and I believe this is the same also in Pakistan, so if you suspect if you have a patient suspected to have Duchenne muscular dystrophy or Becker muscular dystrophy, first thing you need to do is MLP analysis. So 70% of cases will be diagnosed, but the problem is 30%, the remaining cases. 30% of cases, you need muscle biopsy. And if muscle biopsy shows dystrophin, the presence of dystrophin, it means that your patient does not have Duchenne muscular dystrophy. It means your patient has something else. But if dystrophin is absent, of course, diagnosis is already made, Duchenne or Becker muscular dystrophy. But still, now you need sequencing because I will tell you later, now coming therapies are depending on mutation, the type of mutation. So you still need to know that mutation. So we need sequencing analysis. Yeah, this one. For example, exon skipping one therapy was just approved by FDA this year. There was a big discussion, and still there is big criticism, but still this is a very important and very good news to our field because there was basically no therapy for Duchenne muscular dystrophy, no curative therapy for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So exons, yes, and also the read-through therapy. This is, if you have nonsense or stop codon mutation, this will be read through by some agent called Ataruren. And this was already approved, conditionally approved by EMA in EU. So, and this is already used. And of course, for this one, you have to be very sure that your patient has stop codon mutation. So those, actually, therapies are really mutation dependent. For exon 51 skipping therapy, your patient must have mutation or deletion involving exon 50, otherwise it doesn't work. So these therapies are really mutation specific. Okay, so all coming therapies are really mutation specific, so you really need to make a genetic diagnosis. In the rest of my talk, I have three cases to discuss with you. So this is a 6-month-old girl. As you see, you can see she's a floppy infant, very floppy. And as you can see, she has hepatomegaly as well. But the most important abnormality is this one, cardiomegaly. So she is a floppy infant with cardiomegaly. So if you are a pediatrician, you will immediately think about one disease. What is the diagnosis? Maybe you are all adult neurologists. Actually, if you do muscle biopsy, muscle fibers have very big vacuoles with something amorphous and basophilic in color. This is already diagnostic feature. This is Pompe disease. And on modified Gomery trichrome again, you see basophilic material inside. Okay, this is Pompe disease. The reason why I talked about this disease is now enzyme replacement therapy is available. So the efficacy was initially shown in infantile patients, just like the case I showed. So in this clinical trial, they compared the data with historical controls. So in this historical control, 60 patients out of 61 died before age 18, before age 1.5. Okay? So it means, practically speaking, all patients die before age 18 months, right? But with enzyme replacement therapy, everybody survived. So efficacy was so obvious. So this is a 10-month-old girl. You see, she was not able to raise her head. So this is really floppy infant. So she is supposed to die before age 1.5, right? Can you, yes. Can you click this one? She is already 2 years and 3 months. She was supposed to die. So impressive, right? I like to see this video again and again. I'm sure everybody is impressed and everybody likes this video. You are a clinician. I'm sure you like it. So this is so dramatic, right? So it means that, yes, Pompe disease is treatable. And of course, you shouldn't miss the diagnosis. If you miss the diagnosis, patient will die. But if you make a diagnosis, patient will be like this, totally different. Patient number two, 41-year-old man, gait disturbance. He has several months history of muscle weakness, proximal muscle weakness, CK very high. Now he has mild dysphagia. And muscle biopsy was done. Facial muscle was spared, mainly on physical examination, he had proximal and truncal weakness. And at the time of admission, he had still high CK, 6,000. Diagnosis. Several months history, adults, proximal muscle weakness, progressive proximal muscle weakness, high CK, no skin rash, no facial muscle involvement. I think I know many of you are faculty members, professors. So I'm sure you have to do ward round with residents. And if you have this type of patient, I'm almost sure that you will say polymyositis, right? No skin rash, several months history. progressive proximal weakness, high CK, right? Polymyositis. I think you will say polymyositis. Differential diagnosis. So of course you have to think about acquired disease, inflammatory myopathy, polymyositis, or muscular dystrophy. But in adults, several months history, very unlikely, right? Or you may list up muscular dystrophy, but practically it's almost impossible, right? And or others, metabolic myopathy or others. So this is muscle pathology. See, we see necrotic fiber here, there, and also regenerating fibers here, and variation in fiber size, and mild endomyogenic fibrosis. So it looks a bit dystrophic. And there's basically no lymphocyte infiltration, no inflammatory cells, right? So then you can say this is polymyositis, immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy, or some other people call necrotizing autoimmune myopathy. Either is this okay, so they are the same. Actually, many samples, like 80% of muscle biopsies come to our lab. In 2012, already 4 years ago, we had 730 cases. Among them, around one-third of them are somehow myositis suspected cases. Okay? Among them, 35% were clinically diagnosed or suspected to have polymyositis. Around 20% dermatomyositis. 17% IBM, inclusion body myositis, and others. As you probably know, IBM is a disease of elderly, and it shows rather unique muscle involvement pattern. So this is a very unique disease. This is a little bit different. So this clearly shows that our neurologists, clinicians, they have only two inflammatory myopathies in their head, polymyositis or dermatomyositis. If there is skin rash, dermatomyositis. If there is no skin rash, polymyositis. Very clear, right? Because they don't have any other disorders in their brain. But the reality is this one. This is after pathological diagnosis. We have only few patients with polymyositis. Most frequent one is necrotizing myopathy. Okay? Because this is actually because nowadays the definition of polymyositis is getting more and more strict. We have to see lymphocyte infiltration into non-necrotic fiber. Otherwise, we never make a diagnosis of polymyositis. For this reason, actually, we almost never make a diagnosis of polymyositis. Very, very rare. And in fact, many of the cases who were clinically diagnosed as polymyositis actually have necrotizing myopathy. So when you do word round, don't say polymyositis. You will lose the game. Please say necrotizing myopathy, because most of the cases actually have necrotizing myopathy. Okay, actually we now know that necrotizing myopathies are often associated with specific autoantibodies. One is SRP, the other one is HMGCR. Well, I don't go into the detail, but we have many cases with necrotizing myopathy, and actually HMGCR is the enzyme which is blocked by statin, and this disease was originally identified among patients with statin myopathy with high CK. But so the statin exposure was really emphasized in the beginning. But in our series, yes, of course, as compared with anti-SRP myopathy, yes, we still have many patients, more patients, and have HMGCR myopathy. But look at this. Actually, majority of cases, they have never taken statin. We even have pediatric cases, of course, they never take statin at all, right? So, yes, statin is probably an important risk factor, but it's not always. You shouldn't exclude the possibility. And I want to focus on this one. Surprisingly, there are pediatric cases. We recently reported this one. Actually, this is in collaboration among AOMC countries, Taiwan and China and Japan. And look at this one. So we reported 9 cases. 4 out of 9 cases, they were clinically suspected to have muscular dystrophy. And I just wrote like a graph. So, for example, this case onset is 10 months old. And after 6 months, the diagnosis was made. This case, Taiwanese case, onset is 3 years. And at 4 years, he came to the clinic. So if you have a patient, 4-year-old boy, 1 year history of progressive weakness and high CK, of course you have to think about possibility of muscular dystrophy, right? So I think this is very important because it means that among muscular dystrophy phenotype patients, there are inflammatory myopathy patients which are treatable. So you shouldn't miss them. And this is the classification of current classification of inflammatory myopathy. So this Bohan and Peter classification has been used for a long, long time, and actually this is still used especially among rheumatologists. According to this classification, there are only 2 diseases: dermatomyositis and polymyositis. Okay. Japanese clinicians, they have this concept still, unfortunately. But actually, the most frequently currently used the classification is this one. So in addition to dermatomyositis, polymyositis, and IBM, this one, immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy, was added. Yes. So this is a new classification. But more recently, actually, another class, subclass of inflammatory myopathy has been added. This is called antisynthetase syndrome. So antisynthetase syndrome and also immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy, both conditions are associated with specific autoantibodies. So measuring autoantibodies are now very important to make a diagnosis of inflammatory myopathy. For necrotizing myopathy, as I mentioned, anti-SRP antibodies and HMGCR antibodies are very important to make a diagnosis. Antisynthetase are include JO1, OJ, right? But if you find one of those antisynthetase antibodies, then you can call it antisynthetase syndrome or antisynthetase myopathy. Also, dermatomyositis, now we know that at least 5 autoantibodies are specifically associated with dermatomyositis. So the importance of the measuring or evaluating autoantibodies in myositis field is being more and more recognized. Okay, and for therapy for immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy, unfortunately, there is no big study, so evidence level is not high. But many experts say that just using steroid doesn't help that much. So we need to try something like IVIG or methotrexate or rituximab. Or you have to search for the best one. In some cases, an anti-HMG-CR myopathy case, some cases show really rapid progressive course. This is actually, this is also the collaboration through AOMC. This patient is the first Thai patient with anti-HMG-CR antibodies. So she actually became like this only 9 days after the onset of weakness. Immediately became like this. But after 5 weeks after IVIG, now she became like this. Right? So if you make a right diagnosis, you can help them. On the other hand, this is a 16-year-old girl. The onset was 8 years. And she was diagnosed as muscular dystrophy for a long, long time. And this muscle biopsy was done at age 16, and this was sent to us. Yes, looked like muscular dystrophy. Marked endometrial and myogenital fibrosis, right? Fiber size variation. But we found anti-HMG-CR autoantibodies. And clinicians immediately started IVIG and other immunosuppressant, but, well, she showed improvement only a little bit. Probably because if you have this much fibrosis, there's no more improvement. You cannot expect improvement that much. So it means that you should make a diagnosis as early as possible because this is essentially a treatable condition, right? Yeah, so if you can make a diagnosis, you can really help, you know, this type of patient. Okay, the last patient, 39-year-old lady. So like several months, history of proximal weakness, but importantly, she had head drop like this. And now difficulty running, difficulty raising arms, standing up, okay. CK is not that much elevated. And she had M proteinemia. We did muscle biopsy, you know, marked fiber size variation. And this is modified Gomery trichrome. You see something unusual in the muscle fibers, right? Darkly stained, dot-like structure. Actually, all of them are nemaline bodies. Okay, so the diagnosis should be nemaline myopathy because there are so many fibers with nemaline bodies. Yeah, they are nemaline bodies. Yes, diagnosis nemaline myopathy. But, you know, this is an adult and only several months history. So it's a bit unlikely to have congenital myopathy, right? Like a hereditary myopathy. Right? So this must be something acquired. Actually, this is a disease called sporadic late onset nemaline myopathy. This is not hereditary disease, acquired disease. We still don't know the mechanism, but there are patients like this. It's long. Okay? Usually adult onset, subacute, progressive, and proximal and axial muscle are involved. And they often show head drop and often respiratory failure as well. And can look like motor neuron disease. The reason why I chose this case is this one. Of course, there is no big study because this disease is very rare. But there are two important reports. Both said that MGUS, M-proteinemia or monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance, so M-proteinemia. So Sloan with M-proteinemia, they have very poor prognosis. Look at this one. The first report, reported 10 years ago, they said that with MGUS, 5 out of 7 died because of respiratory failure. And you may think that 2 are still alive, but actually 2 are not actually followed that long, just maybe one year or 2 years. If you wait maybe 2 more years, they may die probably. So it means that this is a lethal disease. They will die almost for sure within maybe several years. But without MGUS, they all survived. So this is very important. With MGUS, this is a lethal disease. But without MGUS, okay, you can survive. And another important paper published 2 years ago, they said that if you treat them almost like multiple myeloma with melphalan and also stem cell therapy, autologous stem cell therapy, a transplantation, then they almost all of them are survived. One died because that case was already at the time of when they started treatment. Actually, that patient was almost dying, so too late. So it means that, of course, we still need more cases, more studies, but it means that with MGUS, they die. But if you treat them, they survive. So it clearly shows the importance, the role of neurologist is very important. You can really save them, right? This is, we also have a case, this is a Japanese case. This is before bone marrow transplantation, okay? He has difficulty raising his head. But after this, he was normalized. Muscle weakness is normalized. Again, if you don't make a diagnosis, he will die. He can survive, not just survive. Muscle weakness is gone as well, right? So if you can make a diagnosis, his life will be totally different, right? Okay, so nemaline myopathy is, okay, most of them are congenital one, but there are acquired nemaline myopathy. This is called sporadic late onset nemaline myopathy. And whenever you find this disease, you have to immediately check the presence or absence of M proteinemia. And if M proteinemia is there, you should radically treat your patient. Then you can survive. You can save their lives. Okay. All right, so this is the summary of my talk. So now we are in the period of paradigm shift. In the future, I think that muscle disease, all hereditary muscle disease, will be redefined by mutation and gene characters. But at this moment, we need to establish genotype-phenotype correlation. Of course, genotyping is important, but phenotyping is still very important, clinical and pathological evaluation. For this, muscle pathology still plays a central role, and also I emphasize the importance of muscle imaging. Genetic diagnosis, of course, this is very important, and especially not just make a diagnosis, especially because many of coming therapies are mutation dependent, mutation specific, so you need to know the mutation, patient's mutation, otherwise you can't treat them. And finally, I discussed some cases with you, because of course not so many muscle diseases, still I have to say there is no curative therapy, but there are treatable muscle diseases, right? So sporadic late onset nemaline myopathy, you can save their lives if you know this disease, right? You completely change patient's life. Okay, so do not miss treatable disease, treatable patients. Okay, so this is our lab. So we have many former foreign postdocs and fellows, as you can see, and many of them are from AOMC countries. I hope some of you will come to our lab and to work on muscle disease. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Nishino. We can take one or two questions, if there are any, before going to tea break.
Actually, that's a very difficult question. Nobody knows. Even adults, nobody knows why we produce autoantibodies against SRP or HMGCR or other antigens. It's still a mystery.
Yes.
And also, we still don't know why we have necrotizing myopathy when we have autoantibodies against SRP or HMGCR. Those proteins are normally present in the cytoplasm.
Yes.
Sure.
Thank you very much again for a wonderful talk. You did mention about taking the emphasis a little bit away from the statin-induced myopathy and looking at the necrotizing myopathy. But tell us about this statin-induced myalgias. And what is your take on that?
Yeah, actually, among all statin myopathy, necrotizing myopathy is not actually the most frequent subtype. And as you pointed out, the myalgia is probably the most frequent phenotype among all statin myopathies. But probably the mechanism is different from necrotizing myopathy, because many of myalgia patients don't show really elevated CK level. Yes, or can be even mild. Yes, can be even normal. So the myalgia, I think the mechanism is still not known very well, but the mechanism should be different from necrotizing myopathy. And also there are cases who showed rhabdomyolysis. Yes, among all statin users. But probably this is also, there should be another different type of mechanism from immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy. Yes, so still there are so many unknown things.